Hello and thank you for tuning in. I'm Johnny Ray.
And I'm Allie Havens. In local news tonight, Jeffrey Spiegler, a keen mental health counselor, was indicted on charges of attempted sexual assault, violation of privacy, and falsifying physical evidence.
Spiegler was arrested in June for recording a teenage girl in her bathroom with a cell phone camera and then entering her room and rubbing her thigh while she was sleeping. He first denied the charges and then admitted to filming her at least six times.
When the police attempted to confiscate his phone and laptop, he claimed the laptop had been stolen. He really threw it into a pond, where the police later retrieved the laptop.
A Spofford firefighter pled guilty to theft last Monday. Matthew D. Coleman was ordered to repay close to $900 for gas he stole last year.
Coleman was sentenced to 30 days in jail, suspended for 2 years, and restitution to the fire department by December 1st by Judge Edward J. Burke, who's been known to throw people in jail for wearing hats in his courtroom.
Indeed. In more local news, four people were arrested in heroin-related drug charges. Three of the arrestees were family members, and all four lived together in Keene. Police arrested them after a 10-day investigation.
Those arrested are Christopher Sander, charged with three counts of sale of heroin, Ryan Sander, charged with possession of heroin, Mark Sander, charged with possession with intent to sell heroin, and Paige Wilson, charged with possession of heroin.
The arrest warrants were granted after Christopher Sander was allegedly observed selling heroin on three consecutive days in July in an alley off of Court Street.
With the arrest and search warrants issued, police found more than $1,000 worth of heroin and a scale in Mark Sander's bedroom.
The charges could be enhanced since the residence is located within 1,000 feet of a school.
In state news, seven men were arrested and charged with a prostitution-related crime, which is a misdemeanor. One man, a registered sex offender, was held on a probation violation.
Police allege the men agreed to pay the undercover female police officer in exchange for sexual contact.
I don't know how common this is for people to be arrested for prostitution-related crime, but however common prostitution is, or people paying others for sex, I don't think that people should be arrested for it.
I'm with you there.
Same thing with drugs, I feel like. Paying someone for a service, whether it's, you know, whether it's sex or whether it's drugs, I think that, like, the paying people for heroin is a little different because heroin is a sort of scary drug or really scary drug where, you know, it's ruined people's lives and that it doesn't really necessarily do anything that's in the long-term self-interest of an individual. But I don't think that sending them to prison where they can learn how to be better criminals and find drugs cheaper and have less chances of getting caught in the future, I don't think that prison is the best place for those people. I think that somewhere like a rehab or, this is like three people within one family that were arrested for this.
Uh-huh.
So all these people are going into the system where they're coming in contact with more criminals and learning how to do what they do even better. And I think that sending them to a place like rehab would make more sense, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I do. I think what makes the most sense, really, is for people to organize themselves and sort of the kind of societies they want to on a voluntary basis.
Mm-hmm.
And then maybe if they wanted to live in a place where you couldn't, if you were branded as a drug user or a drug seller, then maybe none of the merchants there would sell you food and it just wouldn't be possible for you to live there.
Right.
Instead of having a one-size-fits-all system like we do now where the federal government lists certain drugs that are controlled and everybody has to abide by the federal government and what the people up there decide is allowed for you to do to yourself.
Yeah, and it also seems to be more of something where, like, it seems to be like poverty induces a sort of these sort of trades. Like, I'm not saying that wealthy people don't, you know, buy prostitutes too, but you know, the people engaging in the kind of prostitution where, you know, you might have undercover cops involved, a lot of that I think is sort of like it's striking the poor It's like the police are going after those who are impoverished because they're more likely to be involved in these types of crimes, which is really just their way of sustaining themselves because, you know, the culture that they're involved in sort of allows for, it makes it easier to be involved in the black market and make money or make a living doing that. Whereas if they weren't hit so hard by the sort of top-down economy, that they probably wouldn't be in that situation in the first place. Like there might be, you know, like maybe without the minimum wage and like these restrictions on labor, that there would be, it would be easier to get a job even if you were sort of at the end of your rope and didn't really have a lot of job experience, or maybe you've been to jail before, that wouldn't be so difficult to find work. But now, in these days, with the recession and everything, a lot of people are turning to prostitution and drug selling when they might otherwise just find something else to do.
Yeah, I believe that government regulations make it more difficult to create wealth, create a business. And so it drives people underground into, you know, doing things like selling their body.
Especially when it's so profitable.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I mean, if you look at the kind of money that people make selling drugs, and I don't know about prostitution, but I mean, you make a lot more money than you might make doing minimum wage, but then again, the risk is higher because you've got these undercover officers involved in your trade, sort of participating almost like a rival, like your competition, involved in the drug trade and prostitution, where they make money by busting people as opposed to actually providing the service. So it's like your competition that sort of works on different, with different rules involved, because the way they make money is by busting people as opposed by making, you know, whatever trade it is, like a good trade. Although the black market is pretty susceptible to, you know, fraud and things like that, which is why we should legalize these things so that people have choice and so that people don't get ripped off and it doesn't become such a seedy sort of gross thing that when people hear about, you know, others going to prison for these things, they don't go, oh, well, that's good, because everyone knows that people that buy prostitutes and people that, you know, smoke heroin belong in jail. Well, you might not think that if it wasn't something that's been driven underground.
Right, right. And it's better to know, especially with some of the really, really creepier aspects of, I don't know, prostitution or drug use or anything. It's just, It's better if that stuff is transparent and people do it and you know who you're dealing with, and mm-hmm. people don't have to hide their true nature from the rest of the world, and you can deal with them from knowledge, which is better for everybody.
Right. I think it's time for people to accept that, you know, there are lots of people in our society that have a problem with drugs, and you know, the more we put it off and pretend like it doesn't exist, the worse it's going to get.
Right, because I imagine if the floodgates were opened, some people would kill themselves on the kind of drugs that would that they'd have access to. You know, say the price of heroin went way down. Mm-hmm. I think some people would die as a result of the drug becoming legal.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we should accept that because it'll teach people how dangerous the drugs are, and the fact that drugs are illegal gives them a certain mystique, you know, kind of a chicness.
Right. That, creates. It does drive demand up when they make a drug illegal. Demand goes way up because also it creates a more incentive, like the profits get higher because of the risk. So a lot of people get pulled into this industry of, you know, illicit substances when otherwise it wouldn't exist.
Uh-huh.
You know, like we all know about how back in the olden days you used to be able to buy heroin down at the drugstore.
Right.
You know, it's the same drug.
I know that from the movie Tombstone. Because
now in more state news, the Farm to Table project shows Manchester teens how food makes it from the garden to the table. The project is a 10-week program that teaches 6 teens how to grow, cook, and market their own products.
This project helps youths that come from unstable backgrounds and teaches them valuable life skills. Not only are the teens learning to garden, they are also learning how to cook with herbs and vegetables they have cultivated.
This will eventually lead to teens creating a tomato sauce they will produce and learn how to market. They will also be learning how to develop a business plan.
Valuable life skills indeed.
Now for a video update on Adamo Freeman's incarceration and upcoming trial for wiretapping.
In early 2010, Jonathan Duchenese, Matthew Yayuga, Michael Buckley, and Ernie Goodnow beat up a man named Chris Meklevich outside a bar in Manchester, New Hampshire.
The incident received front page coverage in the Union Leader, the most circulated paper in the state. Yet Thomas Clark, Manchester's city solicitor, opted not to bring charges against the four aggressors.
Many were sure that Michael Delaney, New Hampshire's Attorney General, would act. Yet a year after the incident, Delaney announced that he was not going to bring charges against the perpetrators.
But perhaps this isn't too surprising. After all, the four assailants were employed as police officers at Manchester Police Department.
A week after Delaney's statement, a few dozen individuals came together and held a pro-police accountability rally outside the Manchester Police Department. The goal? Bring to light the double standards.
Some had conversations with passersby and employees of the police department. Some held signs, and some used non-toxic children's chalk to write statements on the sidewalk and on the building itself, pointing out the clear double standards.
Bullies want to censor their misdeeds.
Nine present had their cameras and cell phones taken. Then the arrests started, eight in total.
Adamo Freeman was the first arrested.
Not wanting to aid in his capture, he went limp. He was passive. For that, he was charged with resisting.
A few months later, he was told by Judge William H. Lyons, a former cop and prosecutor, that he was guilty of resisting. Adamo was sentenced to the max, 12 months in a cage, with 10 months suspended.
Does this sound reasonable?
Adamo appealed, hoping to make his case to a jury.
He was told he'd receive a letter with his court date. That never happened. But he did receive a letter telling him that he had missed his court date.
It seems a court bureaucrat either accidentally or purposefully sent the notification about his jury selection to an incorrect address. In fact, it was sent to an address that didn't even exist.
Let us clarify.
Adamo was found guilty of resisting for going limp. He appealed, hoping to make his case to a jury of his peers. Though he received mail from the same court at his address before and after the notification, the one about his appeal date never made it to him.
Adamo went to his sentencing.
He informed Lyons of the paperwork oversight. Lyons told him he couldn't do anything about it, and he told Adamo he'd have to sit the time.
He's currently caged at Hillsborough County Jail in Manchester.
But that's not the end of the story. Far from it.
After Adamo's arrest last summer, he spent some time in Manchester doing outreach, handing out DVDs, and encouraging people to share their own stories of mistreatment from the Manchester PD employees. All of this was documented heavily on copblock.org.
A couple of the people he interacted with were students at Manchester's West High School. After a brief exchange informing them of their rights, Adamo gave them a DVD and moved on.
A week after that interaction, the students, Frank Harrington and Mike Pruhl, found Adamo and explained an incident that had happened that day at school.
Pruhl had used a cell phone to capture on video school liaison officer Darren Murphy, a Manchester PD employee, slam Harrington's head off a cafeteria table.
Harrington's sister also attended West High School, and he had taken her purse as a joke. Murphy approached Harrington and asked for the purse. Harrington said he was going to return it to his sister, but Murphy took the purse and looked through it without a warrant.
Murphy then told Harrington he was under arrest, and when Harrington used an expletive to express his frustration, Murphy grabbed him, spun him around, and slammed his head on the table.
Adamo interviewed Harrington and Pruhl, and posted video of the exchange online.
The following day, Adamo called the Manchester Police Department and West High School seeking comment about Murphy's actions.
His concern? The lack of accountability. Darren Murphy was in the school the next day without any repercussions.
His phone call to Manchester PD was brief. The person who answered didn't seem to express any concern upon hearing that his colleague might have assaulted a teenager.
His phone call to West High School wasn't very fruitful either. The secretary merely passed along his call, and the principal, Mary Ellen McGorry, who used to work as an assistant attorney for Hillsborough County, only attempted to justify Murphy's actions and deflect by saying that the Manchester police were investigating.
Think about that for a moment. A grown adult initiated force. He slammed a teenager's head off a table. Is that the proper response to a swear word? And he was back on the job the very next day. Also, West High School admins blocked copblock.org from school computers and banned copblock t-shirts and literature from in the school itself.
For his efforts, Ademo was charged with 3 counts of felony wiretapping, each of which carries a threat of 7 years.
He's due to have trial on August 13th.
In both these situations, Ademo used peaceful means to point out the wrongs done by Manchester police employees. And in both these situations, he's been railroaded.
My mind is free. My conscience is clear. I have no regrets and have done what was right. And I hope people learn from these actions of mine. I know that now is the time to stand up and do something about it.
Ademo just had his 30th birthday in Valley Street Jail yesterday. In national news, the Department of Homeland Security is gearing up for civil unrest prior to the presidential elections. In a report from RT.com, DHS has ordered masses of riot gear equipment in an effort to prepare for potential domestic riots at the upcoming Republican National Convention, the Democratic National Convention, and next year's presidential inauguration.
DHS submitted a rushed request on Wednesday to the Federal Business Opportunities site, which is a portal for federal government procurement requests over $25,000. They are looking to procure 147 riot helmets, 147 sets of upper body and shoulder protection, 152 sets of thigh and groin protection, 147 hard shell shin guards, 156 forearm protectors, and 147 pairs of tactical gloves.
The riot gear will be worn by Federal Protective Services agents tasked with protecting property, grounds, and buildings owned by the federal government. Also, the DHS recently purchased a number of bulletproof checkpoint booths and hired hundreds of new security guards.
The RNC is slated for August 27th through the 30th in Tampa Bay, Florida, while the DNC is slated for September 3rd through the 6th in Charlotte, North Carolina. Watch out, Floridians and Carolinians. Here comes the Department of Homeland Security.
Now to the video we discussed last week about digging ditches and filling them back in.
And renewal. We're dedicated to providing Americans with jobs and getting this economy back on track. That's why we're partnering with public officials and the unemployed to provide sustainable economic development and give hope for the future of America's working class. So what exactly do we do at Earth Supply? I'm glad you asked. Our jobs are shovel ready, literally. First, our excavation specialists insert their shovels into the ground and remove the soil. This presents the problem of an existing hole in the earth, creating a dangerous situation that could lead to hazards, including but not limited to tripping, falling, and bodily injuries. Then there is the renewal process. At Earth Supply, we train professional backfillers to renew the soil in place of the existing hole, restoring the earth to its original condition. Some folks say we're just digging ditches and filling them back up again. But it's about more than that. It's about jobs. And what's more, these union bosses express the willingness of public officials and lawmakers to secure funding for projects just like ours.
Yeah. Right now, it's all about jobs.
It's awful hard for anybody to vote against a jobs bill right now.
It just has to say jobs bill, essentially, right?
Yeah.
Even if there's like sites that we have or sites we want to expand into where there's not really an environmental benefit,
it's a jobs program for the laborers. Do both you guys work for Earth Supply and Renewal, right?
That's correct. Yes. We've just been digging the ditches. Then we dig the ditch, we take the dirt, and we put the dirt, we actually just take the dirt and put it right back in the ground.
It sounds like that, you know, it almost is exactly the same as where we were with Green Jobs Renew York.
So, and you guys are really cool with that, like helping us find public funds, even if it's just, what we do is just, hey, there's some dirt to dig and put it back in the
hole. People are willing to give
you money.
Yeah,
they're willing to give you the money, that's fine. We're doing everything, you know, the Green Jobs Green New York between us, a lot of it's bullshit. You know, a lot of that's going for stuff that...
Yeah.
Oh, really? Like
we're talking about.
Like, you know, what? Yeah, yeah.
Even if it's like you said, bullshit. You know, there's people willing to subsidize bullshit. You know?
Well, I mean, I think the key thing is, even if it's bullshit, I think as long as people are working, that's not bullshit. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Then you're doing a service.
Right.
Whether you're Mitt Romney or you're Barack Obama, it's all about jobs, yeah. Economy, mm-hmm. and getting people to work.
Mm-hmm.
So at least we're doing that.
Yeah.
You just want to get the money.
No. Yeah.
Then you figure out afterwards.
Yeah, we can figure out the other stuff.
Well, you like the WPA.
Yeah.
Yeah, in the 1930s.
Wait, how so?
Well, the Roosevelt did that.
Right.
They dug the roads up, put them back.
Yeah.
But, you know,
well, they got us out of the Great Depression.
Temporarily,
yeah.
It was
yeah.
good thing.
One thing about having a shovel ready.
Yeah.
Yeah. Shovel exactly. Right. It's like we have the shovels, just, you know, kind of basic.
We're ready.
Tell us.
We've got shovel-ready projects all across the country. We are seeing shovels hit the ground.
And we're lucky now in New York State to have one of the best incentive programs in the country called Green Jobs, Green New York.
You know the Green Jobs, Green New York between us? A lot of it's bullshit.
Basically, you start off with simple things, such as replacing your incandescent bulbs with CFLs.
We go out in crews of threes and fours. We switch out light bulbs to energy-efficient light bulbs, energy-efficient shower heads.
You just want to get the money.
No. Yeah.
Then you figure out afterwards.
Yeah, we can figure out the other stuff once the money.
My name is Van Jones. I am the special advisor for Green Jobs.
And this other shit is just way out there.
And also, we replace the refrigerators.
Between us, a lot of it's bullshit. I mean, NYSERDA, that's what they do. They give these grants, and that's what, you know, it's kind of a full-time job just to go after the grants that people offer.
If we had one grant application process put into NYSERDA about 6 months ago, that was 274 pages long. Now, just think about the time, effort, energy, and money that went into preparing this grant application, which we were, by the way, not successful in receiving. So it did hurt a little bit, but this is not uncommon.
Shovel Ready was not as... shovel ready as we expected.
Right. A lot of people have like the same reaction that you guys are having, though. It's like you literally just take the dirt, dig a hole.
No, I've done that on jobs.
Yeah. Oh, you have? Really?
Yeah.
You've done that? Yeah.
You really have to dress up what we do, because all we do is dig holes. We just need excuses to do that, essentially.
A reason why, justification for it.
Yeah, you know, I mean, the more workers we get, the more money you guys get.
Absolutely.
So it's like, that's why we think this is kind of a win-win, you know.
So
do you have people in mind also who kind of could be, you know, office holders, political office holders in New York who can kind of, you know, help us find those, you know, basically excuses to get public funds?
What we do is we have three lobbying firms. We have, in the city, we have Tom McMahon, who his brother used to be
Tommy.
A congressman in Staten Island. We have upstate, we have one for the Democrats. We have Tom Harnett, who works for Meyer Schwazi. He used to be the commissioner of labor, I believe.
Right.
And so we have them for the Democrats. He usually takes care of the assembly. On the Senate side, we have Powers and Company, who used to be the Republican chairman of New York State. So he takes care of the Senate. That's controlled by the Republicans.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we kind of, so we when we go for a bill, you know, you got to get approval of the Senate and the assembly, and then the governor's got to sign it. Well, we have a lobbyist for the Republicans. We have a lobbyist for the Democrats. And that's how we try to push our agenda.
Well, I mean, the legislation.
You can try and.
I don't know specifically. Like Shelley Silver wouldn't say specifically build a dirt. He would approve a grant to do that type of stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Then we'd have to go out and find places where to dig. But he doesn't want to get involved in picking. That's where they get in trouble.
He's not going
to
get involved.
Oh,
trouble.
Okay. So it's like we don't need
specific,
to get that.
You just want to get the money.
No. Yeah.
Then you figure out afterwards.
Yeah, we can figure out the other stuff. Once the money, I mean, there's you know, I mean, look at the state.
And the more sophisticated you become, the more purposeful you can show yourself in your mission, the easier it is to get the money. Put it that way, okay?
Okay. I mean, it is pretty miraculous that we have gotten some grants just to dig holes and
so you get
fill them
out of Jersey. Jersey dried up completely.
So we tap into people like Citizens for Democratic, you know, Citizens Action, Foundation for Working Families, those types of groups that are pretty much, you know, believe in, you know, the kind of things we do, work programs and things like that. So you go, like for Green Jobs, Green New York, we needed a huge lobby.
My colleagues Nadler and
Elliot Engel. Running today like in the primary.
But you're like individual guys. I'm not talking about the bodies themselves.
We're good with Gillibrand
and
Schumer, Chuck mm-hmm. Schumer.
Mm-hmm. So can you go to like Gillibrand and Schumer and say, hey, we need you to pass this bill, and they'll just do it?
Well, they'll support
well,
it.
Well, they'll support it, maybe, you know, well,
nothing's
introduce
sort of
thing.
It's not for hard for anybody to vote against a jobs bill right now.
They do have some good friends.
So help Earth Supply and Renewal put Americans back to work. Go to WeDigJobs.com to sign up and create your own shovel-ready jobs. Together, we'll dig this economy out of the ditch. And then we'll fill it back in again. Now, if you'll excuse me, I gotta go.
That was pretty good, huh?
Now, had you seen that video when we were talking about this last week, and that's what you were talking about?
Yeah, that was the video I was referencing.
Great.
Yeah. I thought one of the things I thought was most interesting about it was that they
should have edited the bit where he goes into the Port-a-John, that joke at the end. They should have cut that because that just didn't work for me.
Well, I think the part where they were in the conference room with the dudes, they were like
Leon and Nisloff guys.
Yeah.
Do you know what that means?
I don't know what the acronyms mean.
I think NYSLOF. I think New York is part of that.
Yeah, probably. Something like that.
And then the sloth part, I don't...
But, like, I like how they mentioned that it's on both sides of the table, like, Democrats and Republicans, both sides you can get to support these kind of bills, these jobs bills, because I've always said that it's always the things where Democrats and Republicans can't... Like, those things that they can come together on are the worst for us. The ones where they're all in agreement on, like war and, you know, make work jobs and things like that. It's always something that really hurts everyone else because, you know, those are things that they can be more expedient in passing since they disagree about a lot of other things.
Yeah. Yeah, and minimum wage. I think even Rush Limbaugh is for minimum wage laws. That's one of the things that kind of where we kind of parted ways. Because when I grew up, I was sort of
you
a lot
Rush.
Of my opinions were informed by listening to Rush. And he would say, you know, welfare spending is bad, but there has to be a little bit. I remember specifically him saying, you've got to have something. But I just always thought, if less is good than zero, that's...
Right.
That's where it's at. That's
the government's
the
best
goal.
That governs least, and the best government is one that governs not at all.
Right.
There you go.
Thank you for joining us tonight. We hope you enjoyed the show.
Join us again next week for another installment of Shire TV for news and analysis. I'm Allie Havens.
And I'm Johnny Ray. May you each, all of you, here in the studio, except for Justin, may each of you find happiness, peace, and prosperity. Shh.